Thank you for joining us today. I'm David Van Slyke, the Dean of the Maxwell School of Citizenship and Public Affairs, and it's my great privilege to welcome you and to introduce today's distinguished speaker, one of Maxwell's own, Ambassador James B. Cunningham. Later tonight, we will celebrate Ambassador Cunningham at a ceremony in which he will receive a George Ahrens Award, which is the highest honor that the Syracuse University Alumni Association bestows upon graduates who have made outstanding contributions in their fields. Clearly, Ambassador Cunningham fits that criteria by any standard, and we are delighted to have him speak with us this afternoon. Some of you may know that before I became dean, I served as chair and faculty in public administration and international affairs here at Maxwell. And some may assume that when they hear Ambassador and Maxwell, their inclination is to assume that the person is a graduate of our top-ranked Masters of Public Administration or International Relations program. But rather, and it should be no surprise, that Ambassador Cunningham is a terrific example of how undergraduate education in the liberal arts is excellent preparation for a life of leadership and service in a variety of contexts. The ambassador, in fact, graduated from Syracuse University magna cum laude in 1974 from the Maxwell School and the College of Arts and Sciences with undergraduate degrees in political science and psychology, largely because the field of political psychology did not exist at the time as its own major. But when you look at his resume, his training is solidly in the liberal arts. And as you listen to him speak today, you'll recognize the hallmark, critical thinking and analytical skills. His ability to consider context, history, culture, and diverse perspectives. And his appreciation of the unique individual, political, economic, and social dimensions of each of the environments he was working in. You'll also recognize in him a dedication to citizenship and public service that is distinctive among Maxwell alumni, and in fulfillment of the Athenian oath of leaving the city not only not less, but greater and more beautiful than it was transmitted to us. I believe that today, perhaps more than ever before, leaders who have benefited from this type of rigorous and interdisciplinary education that helps students think, adapt, and innovate in a range of settings is the kind of leaders that we need for the very challenging and complex problems that face not only our nation, but our world. Ambassador Cunningham has held an extensive and varied list of distinguished assignments, sometimes in very challenging and dangerous situations. He has served as ambassador and deputy ambassador to Afghanistan, ambassador to Israel, consul general for Hong Kong and Macau, ambassador and deputy permanent representative to the United Nations in New York, and he was acting permanent representative to the United Nations for 9 months, including September 11, 2001. After early tours in Stockholm, Washington, Rome, and the U.S. mission to NATO, he was appointed chief of staff to the NATO Secretary General Manfred Werner, serving as his advisor on all NATO issues in the context of nuclear disarmament in Europe, the collapse of the Berlin Wall, and the reunification of Germany, as well as the impending dissolution of the Warsaw Pact and the Soviet Union. After Iraq invaded Kuwait in August 1990, Cunningham became deputy political counselor at the U.S. mission to the United Nations. He served as the deputy director, then as director of the State Department Office of European Security and Political Affairs. He also was deputy chief of mission at the embassy in Rome from 1996 to 1999. Ambassador Cunningham has received multiple awards from the U.S. State Department, the U.S. Secretary of Defense, the President of Afghanistan, and the Conference of Presidents of Major Jewish Organizations. He is the recipient of the President's Meritorious Service Award and the National Performance Review Hammer Award for Innovation in Management. Ambassador Cunningham retired from government service in 2014 with the rank of career minister. He joined the Atlantic Council in 2015 as a senior fellow in the South Asia Center and the Khalilzad Chair, and in 2016 became a non-resident senior fellow. The ambassador is here today with his wife Leslie and their two daughters, Emma and Emily and Abby, and we are delighted that they have joined us. We are fortunate to have us with him this afternoon, and know we are all very much looking forward to his talk. Ambassador Cunningham?
Thank you very much, Dean Van Slyke. I get tired listening to that bio. It seems like pretty a lot of work. And I thank all of you for coming here today when you could very easily be sitting out on the lawn and enjoying this beautiful day. So I appreciate your attending. I want to make some remarks, and then I really want to have a discussion, because I know that some of you won't agree with what I'm going to say. I hope we can have a discussion after that. And I was just thinking, when I was coming in and talking to my family, I used to spend a lot of hours in this hall. I haven't been back here in maybe 40 years. But it's a really good feeling to be back, and I appreciate the honor of being asked to come here. And I would note that this hall was the site of the course in which I got my lowest grade in my academic career, which was in Professor Mickeljohn's constitutional law course, which was particularly grating because I was planning on becoming a lawyer, not a diplomat. And I never would have imagined, actually, sitting here and when I left Syracuse, that I would end up having the life that I had, even less imagining that I would be honored by Syracuse University for my career. So I'm very grateful for that. Americans today, and indeed all of what I would call the civilized world, are living in a possibly uniquely complicated time and historical space. Change is rapid, and the pace of change is accelerating in ways that we find hard to imagine and even harder to respond to. Threats to our security, traditional and new, are proliferating even as we have imagined that the 21st century would be one of peace and prosperity. The United States is uniquely powerful and influential around the world, notwithstanding all the problems Americans face internally and externally. But we are not doing a very good job of understanding the challenges that we face, nor of having the kind of serious public discussion about how to respond that will be necessary to deal with them effectively and over time. Almost all of these challenges require American leadership and commitment if they are to be addressed in meaningful fashion. That is really the core of our power and influence around the world, and of the ability of our government to protect the security of the American people and to advance their interests. Whether we like it or not, and many of us don't like it, the United States remains the partner of choice for most countries in the world, and there will be better outcomes for our country and for the people of the United States when our country is engaged. The threats to our security today are multiple, often new, and increasingly asymmetrical. That is, relatively unsophisticated acts or a few actors can do great damage. There are now new prospects for state-to-state confrontation as well. Neither we nor our partners are well prepared to deal with them in a coherent, sustained fashion. Among these threats, we are challenged to defend ourselves from the extreme Islamic terrorism that threatens our citizens' values and way of life, while helping to develop and implement a long-term strategy for draining the life from the distorted ideology that animates ISIS, Al-Qaeda, and others. An assertive Russia is challenging the post-Cold War framework and relationships, a framework which I'm proud to say I helped create, that had been intended to achieve at long last a whole European space of freedom and stability. Violence and conflict in the Middle East and beyond have led to traumatic human suffering and pose both immediate and long-term threats, including from a tidal wave of migration. Europe is struggling to deal with new challenges to its unity, identity, and capabilities, a struggle which engages core American interests as well. In Asia, the rise of China and the risks posed by a nuclear North Korea present new and difficult questions. And the list, unfortunately, goes on. Some observers have called this a time of turbulence in the international arena without precedent. But whether or not this is a truly unique period, the world as we know it today is certainly extraordinarily difficult and complex. As we have seen in the debate over globalization, forces at work in the world affect our lives in ways that are hard to foresee or analyze. Our next president and the American people and our many international partners have a complicated security picture in front of them. Of these issues, one of the most vexing and difficult is the threat from violent Islamic extremism and the terrorism it engenders. This is not a threat from Islam itself, but from a distorted ideology that, it is important to recall, is rejected by the vast majority of Muslims around the world. Most of its victims have been people of the Islamic faith, not Americans or others in what we might call the civilized world, the world of values to which most people, including Muslims, around the globe aspire. This ideology is so dangerous precisely because it disdains those values, and its violence strikes at them and the everyday lives of its targets. While this ideology is not an existential threat to America as a nation, I believe it is an existential threat to our way of life. As we have seen, it is deadly, durable, adaptable. It exploits weakness and division, and it will, unfortunately, be a threat to us for some time to come. It's terribly important to keep today's challenges of terrorism in context and to remind ourselves of the generational effort that is required to counter them. Last Sunday was the 15th anniversary of 9/11. I was the U.S. ambassador to the UN that day and saw firsthand the havoc of the tragedy in New York. When I assembled my staff the next day, I predicted that what had happened would change the world in fundamental ways and that the work of protecting the American people and American interests had just been pushed into a new, unknowable realm. The response to the ideology that launched the attacks on 9/11 is still unfolding, and the ideology itself is evolving and appearing in different forms in multiple venues that now reach from Asia to Africa. Collectively, we and the international community as a whole still lack sufficient understanding of this threat and how it relates to multiple conflicts, whether they be state against state or between competing ideologies and religions. But we are learning enough to be able to see that this ideology cannot be defeated as such. We will defeat ISIS, I don't have any doubt about that. But ISIS is not the fundamental problem, horrific as it is. It is a particular expression of the ideology that animates it, Al-Qaeda and others around the world. The task before the world community is to contain and defeat that ideology. The good news is that there is widespread understanding of and agreement on that proposition in capitals around the world. We have many partners in the battle against terror, even in places where American relationships are troubled and difficult. The bad news is the effort has not been effective enough, and we collectively can and must do better, including by engaging our publics frankly on the nature of the threat, what is needed to address it, and what is at risk if we don't. We do know how difficult it is to defeat an ideology and to drain it of relevance. One cannot conquer an ideology by military means, nor are there short-term solutions. There's no silver bullet. Americans like to solve problems, preferably in the short term, and to move on. We don't like long-term commitments, and even less so, long-term conflict. That is perfectly understandable, but after 15 years, it should be clear that approach won't work here. We cannot solve Afghanistan or Syria or attacks on US, French, or Turkish citizens and move on. Defeating violent Islamic extremism will require time, determination, and very importantly, coalitions and Islamic partners. This is not a struggle that the United States can win by itself. And in the end, because the enemy is exploiting a twisted version of religion, the solution must be found in the Islamic world. This war will not be won by military means, although that will remain a vital instrument. We require a sustained, multilateral, and multifaceted strategy aimed at the ideology itself. Now, this is the larger context in which one must view our long engagement in Afghanistan, where I spent the last 3.5 years of my diplomatic career. It is no surprise that the polls show that the majority of Americans doubt whether continued commitment to Afghanistan is worthwhile. Observers have taken to calling Afghanistan America's longest war, often with the implication that it should somehow end. But as we have seen in Iraq, much depends on how the exit of U.S. forces is managed and on what time scale. Premature withdrawal there led to almost disastrous consequences. In Afghanistan, we planned, quite correctly, to transfer security responsibility to the Afghans and to shift the U.S. military role to a train, advise, and assist mission and a counterterrorism mission. That has been accomplished even if the continued support of the U.S. and our partners, albeit at much reduced levels, is essential to the prospects for Afghan success. Fatigue over Afghanistan is more than understandable, but it is not the basis for good policy that protects our interests in a place where we have sacrificed much and have much at stake. We and our many international partners in Afghanistan, including NATO, the EU, and the UN, have established a great coalition precisely because of the shared conviction that Afghanistan remains a vital interest. Our goal from the outset has been to prevent and to help the Afghans themselves prevent Afghanistan from again becoming a platform for those who threaten us and to make it an element for stability in an important region of the world. Despite all the challenges and difficulties, we have had considerable success, and with continued U.S. and international support, we have a strategy that can enable the Afghans to prevail. The United States and its partners, and most particularly our publics, must recognize that the threat to our security that emanates from Afghanistan is one element of the long-term threat that much of the world faces from violence rooted in Islamic extremism. In Afghanistan, we have a willing Islamic partner that wants to contribute to security. Its leaders understand the threat from violent Islamic extremism. Afghanistan must remain a key part of the network of counterterrorism partnerships that the world requires and which needs to be strengthened. There is substantial bipartisan agreement among an array of former leaders of both Republican and Democratic administrations, members of the U.S. Congress on both sides of the aisle, and policy experts on the case for continued U.S. commitment to Afghanistan and an enduring U.S.-Afghan partnership. I hope that such an agreement will extend to the next administration as well. If it does not, I am fairly confident that our next president will have an Afghanistan crisis on his or her desk soon after entering the Oval Office. President Obama's October 15 decision not to complete the withdrawal of U.S. forces by the end of 2016 as planned provided for the first time clarity that there will be a significant U.S. military role in Afghanistan into the next administration without time limit. His decision this year to leave further reductions to his successor was a further vital indicator of U.S. commitment to Afghanistan's security and was supported by our coalition partners who maintained their own commitments. The political task now is to leverage that clarity to provide Afghans confidence that they can succeed and to demonstrate to the Taliban that they cannot. This in turn will promote peace and stability in the region. It must become clear that there will not be space in Afghanistan for Al-Qaeda or ISIS to flourish, nor place for the Taliban absent a political settlement. As Obama stated, the only real way to achieve the full withdrawal of U.S. and foreign troops from Afghanistan is through a lasting political settlement. U.S. and international support for the coming years was reaffirmed at the NATO summit in Warsaw this summer, And there will be complementary affirmation by the international community of extended development assistance in several weeks in a meeting in Brussels. But this support has not been and will not be unconditional. While it has struggled, the Afghan government needs to produce a steady pace of achievements in security, reform, governance, and economic advancement. There is progress, but it is slow. The challenges Afghanistan faces would be daunting, even for a country at peace that is used to coalition politics. Nevertheless, Afghanistan's political class should understand that they need to act in the interest of their country and must not squander the international support which is on offer. Afghanistan is one of, and will remain, one of the poorest countries in the world. The Afghan people have suffered from decades of terrible conflict. But notwithstanding the negative press, Afghanistan is not a failed state. Considerable progress has been made since the ouster of the Taliban. The security situation is, yes, very difficult after the withdrawal by the U.S. and its coalition partners of some 125,000 of the world's best soldiers over the past 5 years. But Afghan security forces are in the lead, fighting and dying for their own country, and for the most part holding their own as they become steadily more capable. Life expectancy has increased by at least 10 years. Infant mortality has been cut in half. More than 8 million children and young adults are in school, many in higher education, and crucially, more than a third of them are women. As the attack on the American University of Afghanistan recently reminds us, education of the exceedingly young population is critical to the future of Afghanistan. While it is a terribly difficult road, important progress has been made in recognizing women's rights. There is a free and dynamic media environment with TV, radio, newspapers, and the internet. Afghanistan's political class and the government of President Ghani are struggling, as expected, after a hotly disputed election. But the fact that millions of Afghan men and women voted in two rounds of presidential elections in 2014, despite the Taliban threats against them, was an impressive exercise in democracy. More than 18 million cell phones link the country as never before in its history. The cities still bustle, and the majority of markets, schools, and health clinics are open. We should not lose sight of Afghanistan as we did after the Soviets left. Succumbing to fatigue will lead to failure of the better future Afghans are working for, deal a serious blow to the war on terror, and ultimately increase the danger to our own people, as Afghan failure feeds the strength of the extremists. Our efforts in Afghanistan are part and parcel of the efforts of the United States to develop and implement a strategy to defend our people and values while draining the life from the perverted version of Islam that animates Daesh, Al-Qaeda, the Taliban, and others. Afghanistan is one part of the campaign since 9/11 to prevail over violent Islamic extremism. That campaign must be sustained, akin to the sustained and ultimately successful efforts during the Cold War to defeat communism. We can and must get smarter at it and learn lessons from what has been achieved and lost thus far. While the defeat of radical Islam can ultimately only come from within the Islamic world, U.S. commitment and leadership will be critical. Frankly, we don't have a lot of great choices, but we should recognize where the wrong ones will lead. Afghanistan's success is part of a larger struggle that the civilized world, including more than 1.5 billion peace-loving Muslims, must win. So thank you for your attention, and I hope we can have a discussion. Yeah, right there.
Thank you very much for a great discussion. And fictionalized great coalition he was speaking of. The numbers don't match up to what your great coalition spoke of. In blood and treasure, we have spent far more proportionally than any European ally, even the good ones, very close. If they're finished, if you were prepared to go forward with this adventure of yours without the Europeans, if they drop out, which it looks like it may happen, would you advocate for us to plug forward all alone by ourselves?
I don't see that that's happening, so it's not. There is no sign that the Europeans are going to drop out. I don't know where your information is coming from. It is true that we have spent more than our partners have, but we have some 50 countries that are engaged with us in the coalition on the ground. We have other partners such as Japan who are spending considerable amounts of money on development and economic support. India has just offered up another $1 billion in development support for Afghanistan. There has been no rush to the exits from the Europeans or from NATO. They have readily agreed to both to the importance of this project and to continue to remain engaged. And indeed, the Germans and some other countries have actually increased their contributions. So I don't think the premise of the question is correct. And I fully expect that those countries will remain engaged with us.
Well, I think the last question is off a good point, however. We've been looking for peace in Afghanistan since, it seems, forever. The Afghans have been at war for 35 years, I think, something like that. This is a long tunnel down which they're looking for the light. Are we going to be able to last it out? Are you going to be able to keep the United States behind you on this seemingly endless effort? Is there any sign that things are getting better? I mean, you mentioned a couple, but they're not terribly impressive. They don't hit the front page.
Thank you for the question. So I spent the first half of my career in European affairs and security affairs in NATO. And all of us who entered my career during all of that period, from the mid-70s until 1989, were told that Germany would never be reunited and the Berlin Wall would never come down. Suddenly, it happened. So I don't at all take it for granted that just because we're in a certain state of being now in this conflict, which has gone on for a long time, although not with our involvement and not with our direct involvement, I don't take it at all for granted that this is an inevitable state of affairs. What I can be pretty sure of is what's going to happen if we don't maintain the kind of effort that I discussed and that you questioned. That's not going to be a good outcome for us. Now, it is a valid policy debate to have that discussion. We can decide to stop doing what we've been doing, which, by the way, has been on a downward slope like that. That is a valid policy choice. We can decide to stop what we've been doing and leave. Everybody else will leave also when and if we do that. There won't be any economic or development assistance either because it won't be maintained at anything like the levels that have existed, that still exist now. The outcome of that scenario is pretty clear. So we will be paying a price if we do that. I don't know when we will pay that price. I keep reminding people as I've been going through this debate for the last couple of years that it's a lot easier to get out of somewhere than to realize you made a mistake and get back in, which is what we're dealing with now in Iraq. But that's a valid policy choice. If we make that choice, we should have a debate about what that means for the future of security, not just in that region, but more broadly throughout the greater Middle East, that is Afghanistan all the way through to Africa, and what that means eventually for the security of our European partners and for the United States. I don't think that's the road that we should go down. I have a pretty clear view of what's going to happen if we do that. but we should have that debate. Up here.
Just continuing on the situation with NATO, considering that the second largest army in NATO just had a failed coup attempt, and a lot of the senior leadership is being purged, what are your thoughts on how Turkey fits into this, and you know, NATO going forward, are there any worries there? The whole Syria, all of that.
Well, the Turks, first let me say that the Turks are one of what we call the framework nations in Afghanistan. They provide the command and a troop presence around the central district around Kabul, and have consistently been engaged both through that and through their own cultural and economic associations. They train Afghan policemen and women, for instance. They're actively engaged in economic projects and development and in working with some of the universities, particularly in the north of Afghanistan. So Turkey has an important and constructive role to play there, and they've been playing it. The coup, of course, and the reaction now and the politics in Turkey are troubling. So far, I'm not aware of any sign that this is rippling out and undermining Turkey's other commitments in places where it's working with us, like Afghanistan. We're having a difficult discussion with them about Syria, which we've been having since the beginning of the Syrian crisis. I can't go back and rehash all the missteps that have been made in Syria, but everybody in Syria has made mistakes. So there's no getting around that. What I hope is going to happen is that the Turkish ship will right itself. Turkey is an important country in that part of the world. Whether we're comfortable with what their political evolution is, how that's evolving, doesn't negate the fact that they have important interests, they have an important role to play, and we should be figuring out how to make the most of that. Historically, we've been able to figure out how to do that, and I hope that we and our other international partners will continue to do that. Turkey has to, particularly in its immediate neighborhood, Turkey has a vital role to play, and we need to make them an effective partner. Up here.
Islamic and European philosophy, and so my question might sound a little bit theoretical, but as they say, practice without theory is blind. So with an interest in political
theory
philosophy.
Theory without practice is equally blind.
Thank you, I agree. So I was. You made a category that you used several times in your talk about the civilized world. Okay, I was wondering what you exactly mean by that. And who determines the values of the civilized world, apart, of course, from general universal claims that we can say any human being would agree upon, like justice and so on. But the problem is usually how you see these values, and this is where civilizations differed. So when you talk about the civilized world, I was wondering what you have, and I would be very interested to know what people do.
Well, you can, first of all, I hope you noted that I included the vast majority of Muslims in that description. Okay, so there are several ways you could identify the civilized world from a certain basic proposition that you shouldn't be murdering innocent women and children. That's a pretty universal value of a civilized world that Daesh and Al-Qaeda don't accept. What I would look at is as epitomizing what you might call a civilized world is the UN Charter, which was an attempt by the international community of all faiths and creeds, levels of prosperity, to try to identify what most people in the world aspired to see the world look like and what they aspired to for their own people, whether they got there through one means or another, through democracy or not, through Christianity or Islam or whatever. Most people, I think, nobody reads the UN Charter anymore. But most people, I think, if they read it, would say, oh, this is pretty general, but it actually does encapsulate the kind of thing that most of us still aspire to, even though we fail at it every day. That's the kind of upper level. The lower level is simply, as I said, you believe in education for everybody. You believe in not murdering people for essentially no reason. You believe in some element of responsible governance, not theological dictatorship. And I could go on, but that's what I mean. What most people would like the world to be, and that is quite different from the vision that that Daesh and Al Qaeda and others like that have.
Let alone countries, of course, that claim to be civilized sometimes do.
Well, nobody's perfect. Least of all the United States. Yes, ma'am.
There's no place for the Al-Qaeda, Daesh, and you said, and you included the Taliban absent a political settlement. Do you think that there is a place for the Taliban in the Afghan government? And should we engage in negotiations to include them in politics?
Yes, I do. And there are, we know, members of the Taliban who also believe that. And that will require a negotiation, and it will require a negotiation based on the renunciation of violence to achieve their aims. We and the Afghan government have at least since before I got there in 2011, have been trying to engage the Taliban in that discussion through a variety of means. We have had that discussion with elements of the Taliban, who have concluded that I hate to use the word military, but have concluded that the military effort is not going to get them what they want, and that they should negotiate a solution that would bring them back into the Afghan political space. That's something the Afghans have to negotiate. But that hasn't happened for a variety of reasons, including the fact that I believe the central leadership of the Taliban still are focused on their principal goal, which is the reestablishment of the Islamic Emirate in Kabul, and simply reestablishing where they were in the 1990s. And that's not something that the vast majority of Afghans want or would accept, just as they didn't before. So the specific challenge for all of us in Afghanistan is to find a way, as I said in my remarks, to find a way to convince the Taliban that they cannot achieve what they hope to achieve on the terror field, if you will, on the battlefield, and that the only way that they can serve their own interests is accepting that that's not the case in negotiating a political solution. We aren't there yet, but a lot of people are trying, and not just us. There's a lot of other countries and elements engaged in trying to shape their thinking in a way that will make that possible. And that also involves the thinking of other countries in the region, and particularly Pakistan. I didn't get into that because I didn't want to go down that path in my remarks, but Pakistan has an important role to play here, and it's pretty clear they haven't made a firm decision to support the kind of outcome that we would like to see. Somebody down here. Sir.
I would appreciate you explaining what you refer to as the peaceful Muslim world and why they are relatively silent on criticizing some of the terrible things that are going on in the world. I use the word relatively. I realize that there are some that do criticize, but when you're talking about the so-called peaceful Muslim world, why is it so minimal, the criticism of what's going on, please?
I'm sure that there are multiple reasons for that, but I agree with you that is a major problem that we collectively need to address. It has been puzzling to me for a long time notwithstanding, I know that there are always risks in taking a stand like that in your own political context, and not just for Muslims, but for any government. They risk, if you have a sensitive issue, you might risk alienating part of your own community, and some countries, I'm sure, are reluctant to do that. They don't want to stir up their own problems within their own countries, their own context. I'm sure that's part of it for some. But I'm convinced that we can collectively do much better at convincing Islamic leaders, and this is now starting to happen, actually, including by religious leaders and others throughout the Islamic world, that we can convince them of the, not just the utility, but of the need for them to accept the fact and act on the acceptance that this is really, at its core, a problem within the Islamic world that they need to take the lead in finding a solution to. And that's why I said we can play an important role, a necessary role in helping to do that, because we can help marshal the international context for that and an international effort to help raise the salience of this publicly around the world. But I agree with you, it hasn't happened the way it should, and it's one of the things we need to do a better job of understanding. Why isn't that happening? What can we do, and what can they do to act on this in a way that is both effective and salient in their own political context? It is a religious issue, but it is fundamentally a political issue. The two are linked, but it is a political necessity in the Islamic world to draw that line and to force the people who are in the wrong side of the line into a smaller and smaller space. Yes, sir.
Let me preface this remark by saying a WAG answer would be perfectly acceptable. Based on your knowledge and saying that our country and the rest of the countries in the world use their best efforts to get Afghanistan right side up, how many years do you think it's going to take to change the tribal concept that exists in Afghanistan?
I interpret from your question that you think the tribal structure is a core problem for the...
It's a big problem. I don't necessarily think it's the core problem.
So if we could fix the tribal structure, we would fix the conflict?
Yeah, I think it's got a lot to do with it. Maybe I'm wrong.
I don't know if you're wrong. I suspect there's certainly an element, as I'm sure you know, there is certainly an element of tribal relations and politics in this conflict. There's no doubt about that. That's something that Afghans have been managing for millennia.
That's the problem.
So that's something that they need to figure out. This is one of the mistakes I think that we made in Afghanistan, is we thought somehow that we could get inside the tribal dynamics as outsiders and fix things where it was inconveniently discordant in various areas around the country. I'm sure we had some people who knew a lot about that stuff, but I'm sure we didn't have very many people, if any, who actually were effective interlocutors in what in effect is a family feud. It's kind of like, you know, you hate your brother-in-law, your next-door neighbor says, I know you both, let me sit you down and we'll sort it out. And then you both go out of the room and say, that guy's crazy and I still hate my brother-in-law.
Well, the question was how many years, and the WAG answer is fine, and I can understand why it would be. You know what WAG answer is?
Well, I'm professionally trained not to make wild ass guesses. And so I'll give you the true answer, which is I don't know. But I'm pretty sure it won't be this year or the next. But it could be. Again, I don't think that is really the core of the problem. It is a cultural reality that Afghans have been dealing with for a long time, and traditionally, Afghans have managed. They're supposed to be. They are known as people who find solutions and conciliate with each other. And they need to find that skill again themselves. I don't believe we can help set up the negotiations, but we have felt for a long time, and I think quite correctly, that this needs to be an Afghan-Afghan solution. And when and if that starts to happen, we're going to have to be pretty accepting of the reality that, you know, it's not going to come out looking like an ideal outcome from our point of view. So we have quite correctly kept our framework pretty specific and linked to certain things. One of those is renunciation of violence, which means no contact with al-Qaeda and terrorism and blowing up women and children in the streets. Respect for the Constitution and for human rights, for women's rights. And within that framework, they will have to find their own solution. And that may well include settling some tribal rivalries or stuff like that. But I think we need to be realistic about what kind of role we can play in that realm.
Genghis Khan.
Right here.
I have two questions. The first one is that one of the more distressing residual images you have of the Karzai regime was the quality and quantity of influence you had was predicated upon how many suitcases of $100 bills were delivered. And I suspect that we were as much a part of that process as the Iranians and everybody else who played in that part of the world. Assuming for the moment that was in fact the case, is it still business as usual? Do we still have to deliver suitcases of $100 bills to get our way in their councils?
The short answer is no. I would say there wasn't a business as usual pattern here, but our relationship with the new government, the government of President Ghani, is on a qualitatively different footing than our relationship was with President Karzai, for a variety of reasons, including that. And I don't want to disparage President Karzai, although I had many, many difficult hours. Talking is the wrong word. Being berated by him. And berating him. But our relationship with him was much different than the relationship we have now with this government. Unfortunately, the reality is this government is in several respects weaker than Karzai's, in part because it is a kind of a coalition and Afghans are not used to this, and it was a very, very hotly disputed election. So there's lots of animosity between the parties. So that is really understandable. If you look how difficult it was simply to get the Democratic Party reunited after the Obama-Clinton context, this is much more extreme. Nonetheless, they have figured out an agenda. It's taken them too long, but they have gotten a government stood up and appointments made, and they are doing things to advance the agenda that they've agreed on, and they have a pretty ambitious agenda, and their differences are not policy differences for the most part. They're more political differences over appointments and distribution of seats in the government, stuff like that, because that's how politics works, including our own, at least up until very recently. So they need time and space to work through that. But the qualitative difference is they do want to reform their country. They do want to make government better and more just. And they do want to be part of a real partnership with the United States and our international partners, because they realize that that's the way forward for Afghanistan if we can figure out how to make it work. And that's a very different mindset from President Karzai's, at least during the last couple years of his presidency when I was dealing with him.
Thank you for that answer. My second question relates to the role of Turkey. It seems that they are certainly the most important players in that part of the world, and a strong relationship between us and they would be important to us, I would think, but that relationship seems to be going in the wrong direction. And I don't know whether that's going to continue to go ever worse and faster, or whether there's something we can do about it. So my question to you is quite simple. What can we do to repair the deteriorated relationship with Turkey and kind of get us back to where we may have been at one time? Thank you.
I'm not an expert in Turkey, but my sense is, not my sense, I know from talking to Turks, that whether it's correct or not, it's the perception of many Turks, not just President Erdogan, that they've been talking to us about what their problems and issues are, and we haven't been listening. We've been hearing, but we haven't been listening. So we listen to what they say and their travails and what they would like to do, and then we just blow them off, basically. I don't think that's true, but I think that's the perception in many places. That was before the coup. After the coup, we have an overlay of additional difficulties, not just in our relationship with Turkey, but with the EU and others as well, who are wary, shall we say, of what Erdogan is doing to reestablish control and to, as he looks at it, root out the coup plotters. But to many people, it looks like basically to just silence all opposition to him and his government, which was a concern before, and a concern that's been growing in Turkey itself. So I think we're gonna go through a period where that dynamic is gonna be a problem. And as I said in response to the other gentleman's question, I think we need to make clear to ourselves and to the Turks what the interests are that we have in common in that part of the world, because Turkey has to be a player and has to be part of the solution. We need to be clear about what our shared interests are and find a way to work on those in the interest of both countries, even while we're going to have tension between us in some of these other areas, and then hope that in the not-too-distant future that ship will right as Turkey calms down and as a greater sense of confidence is restored there. The coup is a considerable shock. Even though Turks have been through this before, I think most Turks were not expecting that. They thought this was a thing of the past, and it was extremely ill-advised and unfortunate. But they need some time to get over it, I think. I'll try back, all the way back there.
Thank you. Ambassador, I have two troubling questions. I hope you don't mind me asking them. Number one.
Troubling to you or to me?
Well, we will find out. First one, you mentioned, talking about Afghanistan, that this is not a conflict that can be won militarily. And you said the solution is in ideological attacks or challenges in the Islamic world. So my question is, we in the United States are certainly not equipped, do not have the credentials to be part of that challenge. And some of our allies, such as Saudi Arabia, seems to have been the grand ideological grandfathers for the ideology of ISIS and Taliban and others. So you mentioned getting a bad grade in this room. If you were giving the United States government a grade in terms of this ideological challenge, frankly, what would that be? Second question. In response
Pass.
To
previous,
pardon me?
Pass.
But I need some elaboration. Second question is that in response to a previous question, you said, yes, Taliban should be a part of the future of Afghanistan, which I can certainly understand, you know, in pragmatic terms, considering the balance of power. But since you also invoked 9/11, if you go back 15 years ago, you recall that we were putting Taliban and Al-Qaeda in the same category, right? Part of the justification for the invasion of Afghanistan was putting an end to the condition, the treatment of women and so forth. It seems to me, however, that 15 years later, thanks to their stamina and power of endurance, right, in of the Taliban, we are now looking at them as potential negotiators, partners, interlocutors, and so forth. So my question is, would the time not come 10 years from now when we will be sitting in this room, and if ISIS and others have the stamina to stay, we will be making the same type of arguments about talking to them that we are making about Taliban today, or various shades of the opposition group in Syria right now, groups that most countries consider as terrorists, and yet we are trying to sort of, you know, put some makeup on the pig and present them as not terrorist groups that can be part of our partnership.
So on the grading question, I only said pass. I don't know if you do this anymore, but when I was a student here, there was a big splurge of courses where they decided grading was inequitable and they went to pass fail. So that's that was the reference. Does that still exist? Nah.
Not much.
I don't think we've done a very good job at understanding the ideological complexity of all this, and in part, there are maybe people in this room who do, because you've been researching it, looking into it, exploring it. You have long experience and backgrounds in it, but that's one of the things that I think we need to do, not just as a government or as an academic community, but as a people. Nobody is explaining very clearly, as far as I know at least, to the American people what this is about. And that is frankly a failure of our government in some respects. And it's something that was frustrating to me when I was in the government. I think Americans deserve, not just Americans, all of our publics deserve a better and clearer understanding of what the causes are of this conflict and what can be done, as I said in my remarks, what can't be done to deal with it. Because we need sustained, as several of you have referenced, we need sustained public understanding of what this is about, and we need sustained public support. And we haven't done a good enough job of, you know, when we have, and I'm not referring to any particular candidate, but when we have candidates for our highest office simply saying that, you know, we're going to solve the problem by bombing it to oblivion, that's neither realistic, but it is also extremely unhelpful in a public context, because it leads people to believe that there is a solution. As I said, there is no silver bullet, there's no silver bomb. That's not going to happen. So we need to get smarter about that and understanding the dynamics of the problem, which is different in different places, by the way, which makes it even more complicated, is important. And the academic community, I think, has a vital role to play in that. On the question of whether someday we will rehabilitate, I take it that was the thrust of your question, that at some point, if ISIS is resilient and strong enough, we will rehabilitate our appreciation of them, shall we say. So there's a fundamental distinction as odious as the Taliban are and the things that they've done, there's a fundamental difference between the Taliban and Al-Qaeda and Daesh. The Taliban were not interested in attacking Europe or the United States or their neighbors particularly. What they were interested in doing is establishing an Islamic emirate in Afghanistan and ruling Afghanistan. Whether they might have eventually developed broader aspirations, I don't know. That could well be. There's a lot of kindred spirits in Pakistan as well. But they were both locally centered, and if you will, their aspirations were to create a religious state, which they did for a short period of time. The reason why we ended up attacking the Taliban was because the 9/11 attacks were planned under their umbrella, and then they refused to do anything about it after 9/11. Since then, we have a long history of enmity, but through various means, we have been talking to them, and others have been talking to them for quite some time about bringing this conflict to a close. And their conflict, there are two parts. They are still linked to Al-Qaeda. Their conflict is rooted in Afghanistan. And for the conflict, we have long thought, we in the international community have long thought that there has to be a political space in Afghanistan for a political Taliban, which is closely aligned to in a very conservative part of the country that is still very conservative. They're just not violent terrorists trying to overthrow the government. So in theory, that's doable. And we have long recognized that there isn't going to be a military solution to the conflict. Even less so, is there going to be a solution to the conflict? Are we going to be able to find a solution to the conflict as long as Pakistan continues to provide safe haven for the Taliban and the Taliban leadership and the Haqqanis? So we have a lot of political work to do in that part of the world that I hope a new administration will approach with renewed vigor and intellectual energy. And I think there is a way out there. ISIS, to me, is beyond the pale. There is no way that I can conceive of that we could find an accommodation with an entity that is so barbaric and whose ideology is so hostile to us. And without being overly dramatic about it, I don't think we're ever going to get to that place. ISIS as a state is not going to survive. It may take a bit of time to get through this, but we and our partners certainly have the means to prevent that from happening. It is already splitting off into other parts of the world where we'll have to deal with it, but as a caliphate, that's not going to happen, I'm pretty sure. But in my view, we don't really have we don't have a choice but to defeat this this group. And we cannot, as I said in my remarks, I consider it to be an existential threat to our way of life. And in a world in which people in Europe and the United States can no longer move freely in our own cities, should that come to pass, is just not acceptable to me, at least. Maybe acceptable to other people, it's not acceptable to me. So there's no way forward here. We have to defeat these people. Yes, ma'am, all the way in the back. I think that was my favorite seat during my course.
I'm a student in the MPAIR program, and I'm studying de-radicalization practices.
Lift the microphone up a little
yes.
bit?
Yes. I'm studying de-radicalization practices, and going off the topic of this discussion, I was wondering what kind of incentives exist to keep people from going towards the extremist narrative, and what kind of disincentives are there to change the minds of extremists that already exist?
Well, that's precisely one of the things in the kind of work that you're doing. It's precisely one of the things that we have to pay more attention to and have more people working on. I don't know the answer to that. I'm not an expert in that field, but I do know that we need to find an answer for it, and I know that a lot of work is being done on that. There are several countries, including Saudi Arabia, for instance, have de-radicalization programs. Some of them, I gather, have pretty good results, and others less so. A lot of work, I think, needs to be done on why people are attracted to this, how those messages can be blunted or turned aside, and how, if they want to, or if they're identified, how can they be, I don't know what the right, de-radicalized, for that's a good term. And that's going to require both political and religious efforts, but also intelligent ways to understand how social media is being used to identify people. There, a little while ago, maybe 2 years ago, there was a view that came up that was expressed for a little while by the American government that this violent extremism was being caused by poverty, and that when people didn't have jobs, they were attracted to violence and extremism. I have two problems with that. First of all, the world is filled with people who live in dire poverty, and most of them don't go around killing other people. And if you define the solution to the problem as eliminating poverty, you've defined the problem as insoluble. So we need to find better ways of parsing all that and locating real trigger factors. Maybe there are some economic factors. Maybe there's some economic factors combined with ideology or religion being proposed in a certain way. I don't know. I'm not an expert in Islam either, but some of you are. Those are the kinds of things that we need to get smarter about and then figure out how to use them. And I know some work is being done on that, but we should treat it as a priority because the problem is great and threatening every day. We're just waiting for another attack to happen.
So would you say that
can you speak up?
Would you say that isn't a priority right now?
I think it is a priority for certain people in certain places, it's something that I expect we could do paying more attention to. Yes, sir.
So you're here to champion us staying in Afghanistan for the long term, which personally I agree with, but it's already shown itself to be something that's getting hard to defend now to the American public, which is why you're here. But as we move forward in, say, the next decade, two decades, with our involvement, what is the risk of our international competitors, such as Russia or China, offering funds that have less strings attached and potentially derailing reforms that we're pushing because their governments are more centralized and they don't have to answer to their publics to the degree that we sometimes do?
I don't think there's very much risk of that. For a variety of historical reasons, some of which are were mistakes and some not. We are the, as Colin Powell said, we broke the bowl, so we own it. And countries like Russia are perfectly willing to see us in that position. I don't think there is anybody who's going to find it to their benefit to try to either supplant the role of the United States and its partners or to counter it. There are some countries that are playing with that notion, but even Russia, which is perfectly happy to see us in NATO involved in a struggling effort to stabilize Afghanistan, realizes that a stable Afghanistan is in their interest. They're just not very interested in making it easier, but they certainly don't want Afghanistan to fail. Neither does Iran. Certainly China doesn't want that, and we have a pretty good relationship working with China and Afghanistan. And even Pakistan is of two minds about what its future role and Afghanistan's future mean to each other, and that's a critical part of the equation that requires also more further and determined work, as some of us have been saying in public. I view Afghanistan as a place where, as long as its own people are stepping up to their responsibilities, even if imperfectly, they will continue to have a broad range of international support. There's a reason for it, but it really is a pretty unique phenomenon that so many countries have invested so much time and political energy and blood and money in trying to get this to work correctly, including, as I said earlier, countries like Japan and India, who aren't normally engaged in this sort of thing. So there's a crucial variable here, which is the role of the Afghans themselves. And I spent the last year that I was in Afghanistan, and since in my public speakings and conversations with Afghan leaders, I have been urging upon them the necessity for them to repeatedly demonstrate that they are moving forward. And even if it's difficult and even if it's slow, that they are making progress. If they continue to do that, and they are, for the time being at least, if they continue to do that, I think they will have the continued support of the international community as long as the United States maintains its support. Yes, sir.
Thanks for coming. Since Afghanistan is such a complex country, what specific policy that our government could propose would be most effective in improving Afghanistan's security?
I think the most critical thing right now is what has finally started to happen or happen, which is that we provide clarity that the United States is going to remain committed to supporting the Afghan security forces. Unfortunately, for the last several years, President Obama's continued expression of desire to get out of Afghanistan completely in stages, which he kept modifying over time as it got more difficult, that lack of clarity about what we were going to do discouraged and disheartened the Afghans and encouraged the Taliban and our enemies and their supporters. I mean, why would you sit down and negotiate a peace agreement if you think that the effort that's supporting your adversary is going to be withdrawn in a year or two or three? So I've never believed that the Taliban were going to negotiate seriously as long as they thought that the United States was leaving. Now that we've made clear, at least I hope we've made clear, depending on the next administration, that that's not going to happen, and that we are committed to preventing the Taliban, not through our own combat operations, but through things that we can do to help the Afghans. We need to take that now and make that a political tool to convince the countries of the region and the adversaries that they are not going to prevail. That's the key to the whole thing. Once we do that, then that opens up the road to a negotiated settlement or a political process of some sort, or to even starting to pick off elements of the insurgents that aren't willing to fight anymore. That's not going to be easy to do, and it's going to take some time still. But the most important thing, to my mind, has always been the clarity of U.S. commitment. There's nothing more important any place in the world, practically, than people understanding what the United States is prepared to do and believing that we're prepared to do what we say. Once you have that, you have a lot of options to play with, to work with.
We have time for one more.
Time for one more. All the way up there.
Being a young person, I'll probably ask something related to young people, and probably we may have some sort of good news away from the doom and gloom.
I thought I was being pretty optimistic.
Yes, I agree with you. Other than Syria, Afghanistan is one of the countries that is having lots of young people leaving the country, going to other countries. And I think this is primarily because of the frustrations that the young people have, lack of employment being one of them, and also the economy being in dire straits. The drought has not helped them really, and the chronic energy crisis as well. Instead of course, sending bags of money or suitcases or whatever it is, what sustainable solutions can the international community help the country with in order for it to reverse its economic fortunes, other than the military effort, and in a way that will stem or stop the outflow of valuable human resource, which has so much energy, which can help in reconstructing the country and taking it back to its glory?
Well, this is a question and an issue that's very much on President Ghani's mind, has been since before he became president. He's very comfortable with economic and development issues and has been seized with this from the outset. He and his colleagues have been frustrated by the fact that they haven't really been able to get the focus on this that they had wanted to because of the conflict and the international turmoil that's going on. But they understand the challenge, and I agree with you. It's a serious issue. So the Afghan government has started its own program, a kind of public works program to generate jobs. Most of the people who are migrating, there are two kinds of migration from Afghanistan. Most of them are economic migrants. They're not fleeing violence, although that's an issue. But they are leaving because they can't find work, or because their families are hedging. So a family is sending one of its sons abroad to work and try to establish a base in Germany or Sweden or wherever, and provide economic support back to the family which is remaining in Afghanistan. The same thing happens in Iran. There are millions of Afghans living and working in Iran, many of them illegally. The other kind of migration that's taking place is the brain drain type. And that's actually more troubling for the system, because the best and the brightest and trained Afghans, whether they're in government or in business, and there is a business community in Afghanistan, whether they're in government or in their own universities and schools or in business, a number of those people are leaving for a combination of concern about security and concern about they have skills that they think that they can use abroad and make considerably more money. That sometimes, maybe often, turns out not to be the case. And we've seen that with Afghans coming to the United States under our special immigrant visa program who had good paying jobs in Afghanistan, but their skills aren't up to the level that make them competitive in an advanced market like America. But anyway, so there are two parts of the phenomenon. The Afghan government is focused on dealing with both of them. One of the things that gives me, and the development community is focused on dealing with both of them. One of the things that gives me hope about Afghanistan is precisely the large numbers of young people, educated young people, who are not leaving, who want to stay, who want to build their country, often at great personal risk, and they stick it out. And a lot of them are quite determined. After all the students at the American University of Afghanistan are, which is not an American government university, by the way, they're all Afghan. After the school was attacked, they were all over the students who had, the vast majority of students, thankfully, who had escaped, were all over the internet and social media asking when they could come back. That's the kind of spirit that the country needs. You know, educate me so I can educate others, educate me so I can do something for my community. And a lot of people are doing that. To answer about the question of the broader question of employment, that's something that we and the government have been struggling with for a long time. I wish I could say that there was an easy way to solve that problem, but we've been dealing with it with mixed success, I think it would be fair to say. But that's very much the focus, is to find jobs for people who are now unemployed. And that a large number of those will be in agriculture, but there are also a significant number of infrastructure and other projects that the international community will be financing, or that other countries will be financing directly to try to provide things that are needed as well as jobs for people who need, you know, regular workaday jobs. And that's going to be ongoing. But the good news is, unlike the previous government, President Karzai didn't really care very much about this stuff, but President Ghani and the people he has working for him really do. So I hope they will be able to make it work.
Thank you all very much for joining us today. Thank you for your respectful questions, and thank you, Ambassador Cunningham, for a very interesting and thought-provoking presentation. Appreciate you all being here. Hope you have a great Orange Central weekend, and go Orange. Thank you so much. This was